Is there a God? Is there anything to this Christianity belief system? Is Jesus Christ real? Is he someone worth pursuing? Well, I wasn't sure about that myself personally for the first 35 years of my life, and that at a key time in my life when I was ready to take my life because I was so miserable living this life and was contemplating suicide. I sought this Jesus Christ, and after two nights, he made himself so real to me. He brought so much love into my being when there was nothing but pain and agony in my body for so many years, like about 35 of them. And he radically transformed my life and has given me an opportunity as of this taping for about 35 years, very close to 35 years, to give other people like myself an opportunity to testify of how Jesus Christ has so powerfully impacted their lives. So my friend, I would encourage you to take the time to hear what some folks have to say on this broadcast. It may be the difference between you experiencing all that God has available to you. You know, we'll never ever, I'm going to tell you something right up front, you will never ever, no human being will ever realize their full potential in this life and especially through eternity if they don't connect with the one who created them. The Bible makes it clear in the New Testament, Jesus Christ, along with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit, created each and every one of us. He has the power to determine our eternity. He has the power to reward us and make us anything he wants in eternity. But he has to be motivated. What motivates him? To pursue, make it our number one pursuit to find out who this Jesus Christ is and what he wants from us, what he expects from us. He expects our devotion. And you're going to be listening to some people passionate, devoted to this one called Jesus on this broadcast. Let's listen to what they have to share.
Me and my husband are sitting at the bar at this restaurant in LA. And I'm not even drinking alcohol or anything. I had a Coke, and I ordered a Coke and some ravioli. And we're sitting there at the bar in the restaurant, and all of a sudden, I get this overwhelming feeling that I'm in hell. And this is a really hard experience for me to explain to somebody, because it's just something that I felt, and it's something that I knew. It wasn't like spoken to me, it wasn't anything audible, it was just something that my mind automatically knew. So I knew that I was hell, and I knew that the feeling that I was feeling was eternal. So I knew that I was eternity, and it was just a feeling that I knew that the condition that I felt would never change. Okay, like never, ever, 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 ever. And that was the really scary part about it, because you knew that horrible feeling that you were feeling would never go away. There was no rest. There was no cure. It was just, you were going to feel like that forever and ever and ever. You wouldn't even be able to die. You would just keep feeling that forever. And the feeling that I felt was eternal separation from God. And it was just something that I knew, okay? It was just something that God showed me. He showed me that he was gone. He was completely out of the picture. That there was just like a gulf separating us, and I could no longer have the benefits of having God there anymore. And so what he showed me was that God is everything. God is love, okay? He's just a being of love, of light, of happiness. Every good thing comes from God. Any feeling of happiness, peace, hope, joy, comfort, love, everything good comes from God. And God is not able to be in the presence of sin, period. He just can't be. Like, it's just an impossibility. So when you die without Jesus and you go to hell, you're basically just going to a place where God doesn't exist anymore. And that place is full of sorrow, pain, agony, depression, no rest, no comfort, no love, nothing. I mean, you take your worst day here on earth and magnify every bad feeling that you've ever felt here, magnify it times like 500 billion. That's what hell is. It's absolute mental anguish. It's mental torment. It's really hard to describe, but it's something that, I mean, you feel like you can't bear it. You feel like you can't even go one more second feeling like that. It's just horrible. I wouldn't wish hell on my worst enemy. I honestly don't believe that anybody deserves that, to go there. It's miserable. It's complete and total mental torment, mental anguish. You just know. And you know when you're there, like, you remember your life on earth and you remember all the people that tried to tell you about Jesus and about salvation. And I remember my pastors and my Sunday school teachers, and I remember them telling me all these things, and I wanted so bad to go back to earth. And you can ask my husband, because I thought that I had died, and I was telling him, how do we die? I don't remember us dying. I said, oh my God, we're in hell. We're in hell. Like, we have died and gone to hell. I remember looking over at my husband, and this is somebody who I love more than anything in the world, but love didn't exist. He was just like this lifeless soul sitting next to me that could do nothing for me. His words didn't comfort me. I didn't even feel any love for him because love didn't exist anymore. It was just horrible. And you knew that, like, you couldn't even go to sleep. Like, you know, every comfort that you even have that you forget about, you know, just like a drink of water, laying down on your comfortable bed on your pillow at night, warm water, just like any type of good comforting feeling, any type of love, any type of goodness that we have here on this earth is in hell. When you die without Jesus, it's all gone, because God is the one who provides all the goodness. God truly is just this being of love and goodness and light. And that's what he taught me whenever I had that vision, when I had that experience. And you know, luckily I came out of it. You know, I went to sleep that night, and the next morning I woke up and I was like, oh, thank you, God, that I'm back on earth. And I just felt so empowered. Like, I have a second chance, you know, like, I didn't die. God didn't let me die without him. And he pulled me out of this. And, you know, I was scared and I tried to laugh it off. You know, I tried to say, oh, it was the marijuana, it was the drugs, you know, maybe something was wrong, maybe it was laced with LSD, you know, maybe something crazy happened. But I could not shake that experience. It was more real to me than anything that I've even felt here on earth. Like, you know, the day my daughter was born, one of the greatest days of my life, that hell experience that I had, it was even more real than that. Like, it is burned inside of my memory. I will never, ever, ever forget it. And, you know, I don't like talking about hell. I think that it's scary. And that experience did scare me for a couple weeks after that. I was scared of God almost. I was like, oh my God, like, what do I need to do? I mean, I gotta get everything in my life right. I gotta be perfect. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. And I just started panicking. And Satan, he was inside my mind trying to lie to me, like, oh, look how mean God is. You know, like, he's going to send you there. Can you believe that? Now you're like under a dictatorship and you just got to do everything that he tells you to do. And, you know, like, I just started panicking and I just started praying. I was like, God, I need to know who you are. I need to know what you want me to do. And God just began to, like, envelop me in love. He didn't condemn me. He didn't tell me I was dirty and nasty and bad. He said, I've been waiting for you to come back. You know, like, I gave this to you so you will know what life is like without me. I didn't give you this experience to scare you. I gave you this experience to show you how much I love you. I gave you this experience to show you what Jesus died to save everybody from. I'm sorry, I'm getting kind of emotional, but it's like when you really truly grasp what Jesus did, like,
God, we don't have to live this way. We don't have to be broken. We don't have to be miserable. And I just began to ask God to show me who you are. Like, what do you want me to do? What do you want from me? And he began to say, I love you. I want you to have a good life. I want you to read the Bible. I want you to seek me. I want you to find me. I want you to follow me. I want you to know that I am love, that I am not this mean God that's standing above you, pointing my finger in your face, telling you that you're not good enough, telling you that you can never be enough. I am the God that is telling you that I sent my son to die to save you from your sins. If you accept Jesus as your savior, you are washed clean. You are able to be in my presence. I am able to live in you and do things through you. And you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to just automatically become this star Christian. You don't automatically have to just do everything right. When you follow me and you love me and you start seeking me and reading my word, the words on the page of the Bible are going to speak to you. They're going to come alive. They're going to show you what you need to do. I'm going to do these things through you. I'm going to do it. You're not going to do it. You can't do it for yourself. You can't be enough. You can't be good enough. And I've always thought before that, like, I had to just, you know, be amazing or God couldn't love me. But God is saying, there's nothing you can do. Like, there aren't works that you can do. There aren't things that you can do to make me love you. I'm never going to love you any more or any less. I love you unconditionally, no matter what you do, no matter who you are, no matter what you've done in your past. And I am here to tell you that life is great. Life is beautiful. Life is about love. It's about finding me, and it's about helping other people, encouraging other people, loving other people. And you know, after that experience, I just began to seek God, and I just had this fire welling up within me. And I'm telling you, I never sat down and read my Bible before. And all of a sudden, I'm a stay-at-home mom, so I have a lot of time on my hands. I started reading the Bible hours a day. I'm talking going on the internet, searching sermons, searching everything, praying hours every single day. And God just began to like open up my mind and open up my heart and transform me. I am telling you that not even one circumstance in my life has changed. Like, I'm still a stay-at-home mom. Nothing has happened amazing for me or my family, you know what I mean? Like, but I am changed. Like, I'm happy. I have so much joy and peace every single day. And I love getting into the Word, and I love reading God's promises. And it's like, the Bible is like this treasure trove of goodness. Like, people are always looking for something to make them happy. Like, you know, money or fame or a boyfriend or a child or whatever it is that they think that they don't have. And they have everything right there in the Bible, in the Word of God. And God is good. And the more that I get to know Him, the more that I know how good He is. And He just shows me things, and He teaches me things, and He loves me. And I just want everyone to know who God truly is, because there are a lot of Christians out there, and I am so sorry, because I have been hurt by them too. Christians who, you know, they judge everybody, and they think that, you know, they're somehow higher than people who don't do exactly what they're supposed to do. But we all fall short, every single one of us. Every single one of us. There are so many judgmental people out there. They hurt you. They try to tell you that you're not enough or you can't be enough. And I am here to tell you that God loves every single person on this earth the exact same. He is not a respecter of persons. He shows no favoritism. All He is asking is for you to come to Him, for you to trust Him, for you to believe that what Jesus did for you. God sent His only Son, Jesus, into this world. He was here in the flesh. He performed miracles while He was here. He loved people while He was here. He had compassion on people while He was here. And He died to save us from hell. When we accept Jesus as our Savior, the blood of Jesus washes us clean, so we are able to be before God as blameless, white as snow. We're righteous in Him. We become what we're supposed to be through Him. He sends His Holy Spirit to live within us, to help us, to guide us, to make us who He meant for us to be. We can't be good on our own. We can't just wake up one day and say, yeah, I'm just going to stop, you know, having sex outside of marriage. I'm going to stop
being an alcoholic, and I'm gonna stop doing this, and I'm gonna stop doing that. Like, you can't just do all that on your own. You need Jesus to help you become who you need to be. And it's not a condemning. You know, God didn't come into the world to condemn it. He came to save it. He came to say, look, you can't do this on your own. I died for you. I already did all the work. And I just want you to accept it. Just accept me. Ask me to be your Lord and Savior, and I am going to blow you away. I'm going to transform you. I'm going to give you peace. I'm going to give you joy. I'm going to give you love for other people. I'm going to overwhelm you with so much love that it's going to burst out of you and spill out of you onto other people. You're not going to even be able to contain the amount of happiness and joy that I'm going to give you. You're going to be able to be happy through any situation. I'm going to be there with you through everything. Just trust in me. And the more that I dig into God's word and like truly study the Bible and read all these promises, they're amazing. I mean, it's like I've learned so much that God is there 24 hours, 7 days a week. We have to just seek him and follow him and love him and pray and get into our Bible. It's honestly, following Jesus, it's the only thing that matters in life. Everything else is not going to bring you joy. It's not going to bring you peace. It's not going to bring you anything. And then God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. You know what that means, guys? That means the desires of your heart. That means the things that you want and you know that you're supposed to do deep down inside, like all your dreams, all your hopes. If you put God first, if you die to yourself, if you give everything to God and really just try to know his heart and become more like him, he will do it through you and he will give you the desires of your heart. He has done it for me. He has just transformed me and changed me. And I know that my purpose is bigger and greater than just being a stay-at-home mom and changing diapers and making meals and cleaning all day. I am here to help people and encourage people and to show them that the love of Christ can change your life, you guys. God is so big. He is so supernatural. He can do anything. And I think that I just needed this boost in my faith because I didn't see God as a supernatural God. I thought that all the miracles were like for the old Bible days, but God is saying, read my word. See, I am doing a new thing. Like, I can use you. I believe that God wants to do awesome things. The Bible says that signs will follow the people who believe, miracles, supernatural things. And I am a firm believer that everything is just changing in my life for the better. And God hears our prayers, you guys. The word says that the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So what does it mean to be righteous? It doesn't mean that you have to be perfect. It means that you invite Jesus to be your Savior. That makes you righteous. So if you have Jesus in your life and you pray and you believe and you have faith, it's just amazing. Like, I just want people to know how good God is. Get into his word, accept him as your Savior, and your life will change. I'm telling you, the worst of the worst situations, he can turn around. He can weave beauty out of the most horrific situation. I don't care what you've done in your past. I don't care who you are. I don't care how disgusting you think you are, how bad you think your life is. God can and will turn it around. He can put a new song in your heart. He can bring you alive. He literally just takes the deadness out of you and makes you alive. He makes you live again. I'm just so excited to share this with people because I didn't really understand this before. I didn't know who the true God was. I thought he hated me. I thought I wasn't enough. And what I'm learning is that God loves you. Oh my God, he loves you so much. He loves you so unconditionally. He is just waiting for you to turn around and come to him and say, God, I need you. I need your help. And he will help you. I promise you. Falling in love with Jesus is the best thing that I've ever done with my life. It's the best decision that I've ever made. It's changing my life. I know that great things are going to happen in my life. I'm going to help people. I'm going to do great things for the kingdom of God. I know my purpose now. And I'm just so happy. You guys, I was dead inside. I was so miserable. I was so depressed. I literally did not think that I could ever be happy again. And like I'm telling you, not even one circumstance in my life has changed, and I'm full of so much joy.
One day, I just started thinking, God, are you real? Why would you not show yourself to me if you're real? And I'd say, God, you know what? You know why I don't believe you're real? I'm going to tell you why. Because I see evil people who don't care about anybody. And they have billions of dollars. Money they can never touch, never spend. They just watch it stockpile. There's kids not eating tonight. Where are you? How do I believe in you? You're the all-knowing, all-loving, and all-caring. Well, this is what I see. Evil people who are prospering, and I see young, innocent children who are going to bed hungry. Some will die of starvation, and I'm wondering where you are. You know, if you are real, please show yourself to me. I want to know. And this is the other thing, God, if you're real, who is the real God? Because am I lucky to be born in the place where people say Jesus is God? Because if I was born elsewhere, I would believe in Allah. If I was a Jew, I wouldn't believe that my Savior has come yet. I could believe in Buddha, you know, Dagon. I could believe in so many of these gods depending on where I was born, what culture I was brought up in. So are you telling me that by where you're born decides if you serve the right God or not? So not only, God, do I want to know if you're real, I want to know who the real God is. And here I am, I'm telling you that if you're real, I want to know. And, you know, I need something more than words, because if someone tries to talk to me about it, it's just words to me. That's just them trying to push their beliefs onto me. Just if I want somebody to believe something I believe, I would try to persuade them that. I need something more than words, God. You know, I do. I did this every day, all day, for 30 days, for 8 hours a day. God, if you're real, show yourself to me. God, if you're real, show yourself to me. Give me something, God. I need to know something. I'm calling out right now. If you're real, please do something to let me know you're here, because the way I'm living, I need a God. I need some divine help. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning. I wake up because I have to go to the bathroom. And I was laying down in a position flat on my back, sort of like this. Except when I woke up, I couldn't move anything. I had no control of my body. I'm trying to scream help, but I can't talk. I could only move my eyeballs. And I've never felt so much fear. And I'm like, this is the strangest experience that has ever happened to me in my life. What happened? So I instantly start researching it, and it's called sleep paralysis. And in ancient time, it's called the demon that stands on one's chest. Demons will attack when someone either does intense research of aliens or plays with the Ouija board, or if they make an advancement towards the kingdom of heaven. Well, I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior, so I would say I made an advancement towards the kingdom of heaven. But I said, I don't want to accept ancient times. I'm in modern Western culture. What does modern science have to say about what happened to me? And through my research, what science comes up with is your body is sleeping, but your consciousness is awake. So I'm like, so science is telling me they're separate. It's early in the morning, the sun's just coming up, and I'm looking at how pretty the different colors in the sky is, and it's like everything in the world looks different to me this day. It's like I was living life in 3D, except I didn't have the glasses. And this day, I had the 3D glasses. I can see intelligence in every cloud, and I just start clapping. I'm like, God, you know, this is beautiful. Everything, you know, thank you so much. Well, as I passed this field, I looked to the right. Out of nowhere, they formed themselves, two of them right next to each other, tornadoes, about 12 feet tall, and just spinning right next to each other. They formed out of nothing, two tornado clouds, spun up, and then dissipated. And I'm like, yes, God is real. I'm cheering. I can't tell you the excitement. I'm like, God is real, and he's revealing himself to me. I look into this day, I'm trying to work. I look into a tree, and the leaves form the face of Jesus Christ. It's just like everywhere I went, everything I did, all I saw was God, God, God. And I'm like, did I lose my mind? Am I going crazy? I mean, what is happening to me? I want to know what's happening with me. I don't understand what's going on. I know you're going to find this hard to believe, but this is what happens. My brother bought me a Bible for becoming a Christian. It was a present from him to me. So I opened the Bible in my room. The pages turn themselves. I'm not making this up. I'll polygraph test this. And go down guide. And it says, if you look for me for like hidden treasure, if you seek me for gold, I don't remember the word for word, but if you really, really look for me and you will find me and I will reveal myself to you and you will have the knowledge of God. Seek me and you will find me. And that's what happened. I earnestly seeked God with all my heart and soul. Got my eyes closed, I'm laying in bed and I'm just relaxed. And I start having experiences like I'm dreaming, except I'm wide awake. I know I'm laying in my bed, except I start flying through space. The wind is blowing in my face. I know I'm laying in my bed though. I'm wide awake, but I'm enjoying this. So I'm just going with it. And then, then the wind is just like, the wind in my room is just like terror. It's like so strong, I have to open my eyes. Well, over my bed is the curtains to the window. The curtains are blowing all up in the air. The ceiling fan's not on. So I have four walls around me. Where is all this wind coming from? Well, that tornado cloud that I told you that I saw previously was like a smaller one came into my room. And when the smoke cleared, it was like a ghost of Jesus Christ. And he manifested into a human form, except he was, it's like he glowed. He just glowed is all I know how to say. And then he went back into like a spirit form, a ghost form, and just disappeared. That whole experience lasted 2 or 3 seconds. I know what happened. I was there. Well, then I close my eyes. I go back into, you know, just meditating and just relax and listen into, you know, like the ocean, the waves, stuff like that. Well, I've never had a real vision in my life. I've heard of them in the Bibles because I'm reading the Bible 2 and 3 hours a night at this time. And all of a sudden, I'm live at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. The first thing I see is Jesus hanging on the cross. But then it goes to before he's on the cross and he gets whipped across his back. And I just see his back. I see him get whipped in the back. And I see his back split open. And the vision goes away. So what that told me, because I hear no voices. Nothing's ever spoken where I hear it. But I took that as, when I called out, God, who are you? Who's the real God? I want to know. The only person that came to me is Jesus Christ, nobody else.
Hi, my name is John Tig. I've been attending service here at the Life Center for about a year and a half, and last Easter I gave my heart to Jesus Christ. My life before finding Jesus was pretty dismal, to the point where I tried to kill myself. I started in the military at a very young age. I was 17. I went into the Navy, then the Marine Corps, then the Israeli Army. I just couldn't get enough of the whole violence culture. And couple that with alcohol and drug abuse, and it made for some pretty interesting times, to say the least. Throughout all of this, though, what was my norm was rage. When I felt enraged, I felt clean and pure, and I had a focus for all of my misery. So I tended to make people targets of my rage to give me something external, because I had nothing inside for me to focus on. It was empty, and I was empty. I have friends that live here in Sacramento that go to this church, Brad and Kelly Behrens. They invited me up, and then they invited me to move up to Sacramento. And I thought that a change of scenery would fix everything that was wrong with me. So I said, sure. So I came up here, and Kelly and Brad started speaking to me about Jesus Christ, and had I read his words and you know, give it a chance. And the thing that stopped me, the thing I couldn't get through my thick Irish head, was I felt because I had done so much wrong, I had physically hurt people, I had emotionally devastated people, I had done all of these very, very bad things, I owed a debt, and that debt had to be paid before I could be forgiven. And what I couldn't get through my head, what Brad and Kelly were saying, was that Jesus Christ paid that debt for me, and there was no need for me to pay it. And I think that was my ego wanting to control the situation. Kelly asked me, well, you've seen where you can take it to. Do you think God can do a better job or not? And yeah, obviously I did. And that's when I started to understand I needed to let go of what I thought was control. Since coming to Jesus, what's changed in my life? Everything. I can't express in words how thankful I am that I have God looking out for me, because it's made my life much easier. It's not that I've abdicated any responsibility. I'm fully responsible for my life, but knowing that I don't have to do this alone. I don't have any PTSD episodes anymore. I haven't since I've been saved. I have no anxiety issues anymore. My medications have been cut by 85%. So God is healing me both physically, emotionally, and spiritually. I wonder sometimes where I'd be had I not accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I truly believe from the bottom of my heart that I would be dead. Because I had already acknowledged that life wasn't worth living. I had attempted to kill myself once. And I think I just would have done a better job the second time. Fortunately, I don't have to deal with that because I did accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and so it's a moot point, thank goodness. The last thing I would like to do is I would like to thank all of you. I'm leaving for Arizona in a few days. My son is 20 and he needs some help and direction. You people have been incredibly kind to me. And I just wanted to take a second to thank all of you. The people who have come up to me when I didn't know anybody here and introduce themselves. Ushers at service that smile and say, hi, how are you? And actually want to hear how you are. And the pastors in the congregation. Thank you so much, all of you. Because you made my transformation from nowhere and a dead end to being alive with Christ just such an easy task. And not even a task, but a joy. So you all have impacted me much more than you all will ever know. But I do want to say thank you to the entire congregation from the heart. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name's Julie. And one thing I've learned about people is that you can look really good on the outside and just be completely miserable on the inside. And that's part of my story. Currently, I am happily married to an amazing guy who I've been with for almost 9 years, and we have two amazing little girls, Kiala and Lily, and I can honestly say I'm so blessed and I'm grateful for my life. However, it wasn't always that way. I didn't look at my life that way, and I honestly didn't think God could use someone like me that was so broken and in so much pain. As a child, I was the kid that was extremely driven and ambitious. overachiever, perfectionistic, extremely competitive, especially with myself. I wanted to be the best at everything. And I also deeply desired to be valued and worthy and significant and loved. And I looked in all the wrong places. And I was addicted to achievements and accolades. And so because of that, I accomplished a lot. I was the straight A student, the leader of many groups. I was an all-star athlete, high school valedictorian, went on to pursue modeling and became a runway model in Chicago and New York. And I pursued a dream of mine and my passion of volleyball to play Division I college volleyball. And all of these accomplishments, you know, made me look like I might appear to have it all together on the outside, but it never worked. It never worked because of the way that I was feeling inside. The pressure was so high, and the more I succeeded, the more I felt the pressure because of my identity was wrapped in those things. And so I was secretly battling low self-esteem and depression. I was battling so much performance and social anxiety, a lot of guilt and shame for pretty much everything I did bad. I felt like a horrible person. I hated myself. I felt like a fake and a phony, and I didn't want anyone to know. Not even my best friends knew that I was battling these things, and I would turn to self-destructive behaviors. I would turn to acting out sexually or partying, drinking, getting drunk, and other self-destructive choices that were harmful to me. And that it would be a vicious cycle, and I would get more and more depressed. And, you know, I believed in God and I was crying out to him, but I just didn't believe that he loved me, that he could. I had so much guilt and shame. And I honestly was believing the lie from the devil that that I had to stay in hiding, and that was his way of keeping power over me. And so he was just feeding me all these lies that I was unlovable, that I was no good, that I was ugly and stupid, and that if anybody knew how I was feeling, nobody would love me, that nobody would accept me. And I believed that lie because I didn't know my identity. And so the devil was definitely trying to get me to feel so miserable that I would rather die than endure the pain.
And in 1 Peter 5:8, it says in the Bible that your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And that's what I feel like he did. He tried to make me so miserable that I wanted to die. And at the age of 23, after a painful breakup and just everything coming up, I attempted suicide because I just did not want to deal with the pain anymore. And I honestly did not want to die. I just was crying out for help. I wanted the pain to leave, and it didn't. And so, you know, Jesus just thankfully had mercy on me. And I'm so thankful I wasn't successful with that, because if I had been successful with that, I think about all that I would have missed out on in life. And it's so hard to think about that my family wouldn't be here. My girls would not be here. That so many people would be suffering, my friends and family, because of that choice. And so it's been such a blessing to now know what I didn't know then, which was that the pain wasn't going to last, that there was hope, and that things were going to get better. And I now understand my authority and my inheritance in Jesus to say, shut up in Jesus' name to those lies, and to know the voice of God. I would say that's the most crucial thing in my journey, is learning how to hear God's voice, and learning how to ask for help. And the enemy wanted me to stay in hiding, but the Lord showed me that through the power and courage of being honest and having a safe place to be real in a Christian community and asking for help, you know, whether it was through counseling or pastors, that that's where real freedom came, and that's where I received love. And I was no longer in bondage through those thoughts, because they were no longer hidden. And so that was a breakthrough in just finding that. And so Christy Pierce's ministry was a big impact of really teaching me how to discern God's voice and understand my identity as a child of God, and receive just inner healing through prayer and through words of encouragement from others, and learning how to go to God when I'm feeling down. And, you know, I can honestly say I still battle depression, anxiety from time to time, but I no longer turn to those self-destructive patterns. I turn to the Lord. I turn to prayer. I turn to His Word. And I'm no longer staying in hiding. I'm honest about it. I'm honest with myself, and I'm honest with God and with my friends. And that's where I found hope and joy and just a sense of freedom that's so powerful. And so I want you to have the courage to find those safe people and safe places and that Christian community where you can be really real about your inner struggles and know that you will be loved and know that will be freeing. And I pray that you would know that you are a child of God who is deeply loved just the way you are. That God knows your hurt and pain. He knows more than anyone that kind of suffering. And He wants to set you free from that. And He has the power to do that. And there is power in His name. That's why even just saying shut up to the enemy in Jesus' name, there's so much power in that. And I just want you to also just know that you don't have to change or be perfect or anything like that. That you are loved just the way you are. And that's good enough.
I was born in a small town in Texas, and I was raised in a very strict Pentecostal upbringing. And I think that shaped how my life, early stages of my life began, and some of the decisions that I make, even my character and personality. Being a part of a Pentecostal holiness church shapes your worldview, how you view yourself, how you view God. My father and my grandfather were both pastors and preachers. And it was expected that all of us children would be part of the church in some way, shape, or fashion. And I love church. I love going to church. I love being the Pentecostal that I was. We did what was called shouting and dancing. It was very exciting being at church. But inside, I had this growing feeling of being different. And I didn't know quite how to describe it to anyone. I didn't know how to even articulate it to myself. But I knew that it was different somehow than, say, other boys my age. I never said anything to anyone about this because in my church, there was this belief and teaching that people who were homosexual would go to hell. Of course, I had not identified myself as a homosexual, but again, there was something different about me in that I had this strange, perhaps, attraction to other boys that, again, I didn't understand. So I didn't call myself a homosexual. But as I began to grow, even in middle and early school age, there was an incident on the playground once where I was chasing a friend. And normal play, what kids do, we chase each other around and we have a lot of fun. But when I caught him this particular moment, this instant, I felt something towards him as I held him. And it sort of scared me. It sort of made me feel good. It was strange. And I think at that time, at age 11, I began to sort of put pieces together here and there about perhaps who I was or what I was feeling. And that just sort of developed on its own because I don't think I had any intervention other than that basic church teaching that if you are a certain way, you will go to hell. And I never wanted to go to hell. I didn't want to feel the way that I felt. And intrinsically, I knew it was wrong, but I didn't quite know what to do about it. And I grew up in a fairly large family with five other brothers and three sisters. Like a lot of African American youth, I grew up in a single parent home where my father was absent. My mother was the breadwinner. She was the provider. She was everything to us, all of us children. And I think that in my heart, I held a lot of hostility towards my father because I didn't know where he was. I didn't know why he wasn't there for me. When in school, I was called different names as people do sometimes when you're different. You know, I was called Sissy. I was called girl sometimes, and I was excluded from playing with other boys because I guess they sensed that it was something different about me as opposed to them. And I ended up actually playing with girls most of the time, something I didn't want to do, but it was, in a sense, forced stone me. And I always wondered, where was my father when I was hurting in my heart and when I felt isolated? Where was he? Why didn't he comfort me? Why didn't he tell me that I wasn't who people said that I was? I was his son. And this feeling in my heart developed where I just wanted a man to say that he loved me, that he affirmed me, that I was worthy to him. And that never happened. And so all of these sort of factors begin to come together where at age 13, I think I just became a target towards an older boy in church. And he ended up sexually molesting me. And that went on for several years. During that time, this crisis developed with my identity. You know, was I homosexual? Was I not? And I really didn't know where to go with that. And so again, I never really told anyone. This molestation carried on for about 4 years until finally, when I was 17 years old, I had had enough of it. This was a love-hate relationship. I hated the fact that he touched me, but there came a point to where I almost wanted him to do it. And it was very, very conflicting to me because again, it in my heart, I knew it wasn't right. It couldn't be right. This wasn't something that God was pleased with. I went to church a lot. I wanted to get rid of this before anybody found out. And I would go to church all the time. I would fast. I would pray. I would go to the altar. I did almost everything I knew to do that people in church said would, you know, make you right with God. And it never happened for me. I would go to revival meetings and I would really hope that somebody would come, somebody I didn't know, and just say something to me like, God is going to heal you, or God is going to make you right. And it was like a fantasy in my mind that I would get rid of this feeling and that kept growing, but it didn't happen. The fact that I was molested brought about several questions in my mind. Why me? What did he see in me to make him want to do this to me? I often wondered, why didn't other people see something and intervene? I did wonder if I was homosexual, and is this something he saw and he just knew it, but I didn't know it? A lot of questions about my identity came up because of this molestation. You know, and I never say that molestation in and of itself caused me to be gay, but it certainly did color how I viewed life and certainly how I viewed my own sexuality. And I began to view it through a broken lens, so to speak. I felt extremely conflicted so many times. There were so many pieces of a puzzle that I couldn't put together. I couldn't bring it together to understand, why was I in this? What did I do to deserve to feel like this or to be this way? Or, you know, and why hadn't God heard my cries? Why didn't God come and deliver me? Like they always told me in church that God was a deliverer. That's what I heard. I heard he could deliver you from anything. But here I was in the midst of all of this Pentecostal holiness, spirit-led, all of this, but it seemed like I was all alone and no one knew except my molester that I was in this hell. And it was not a good time for me. At age 17, I decided that I would end this molestation issue once and for all. And the individual had written me a letter, and I took the letter to the leaders of my church. And I thought that people would see that, you know, here I was an innocent victim, but instead I was blamed. I was told that it's because of you that this happened. And it tore me to pieces spiritually. It shredded all hope that I had of resolving the conflicts in my heart, because I went to people who I thought would help me, but they didn't. And so I decided that I would no longer try to be what I thought God wanted me to be. I decided that I would be a homosexual, and that I didn't care what anybody thought, because I had asked for help. I had been a victim. No one came to my rescue, not even God. He never heard my prayers. And so I decided that I didn't care anymore about trying to be something that perhaps people felt was normal. So I decided I would be a homosexual. And when I graduated from high school, I left church. I left everything that I felt that I had grown up with. I left it behind. I didn't care about what the Bible said. I didn't care about what God said. I didn't care about what people said about me anymore, because I just felt like it was useless. And I had tried, and that there was no help. So now I could live my life the way I wanted to live it. At age 19, I moved away from home to attend college. And it was during that time that I began to experiment more and more find other gay people. I didn't really know anything about gay people, because I grew up in a very, very small town in Texas. And there were no obvious gay people in my town that I knew of, so there was really nobody to connect with. But when I moved to a larger city, I noticed people. I was still sort of afraid to approach them. I didn't know what to say to them, so I just kind of waited for someone to say something to me. And one night I was out walking, and a young man approached me, and he told me that he was going to a party, and he asked me if I wanted to go to this party with him. And I could tell by the look in his eyes it was something different going on. And it kind of excited me because I wanted to find out what this party was all about. And so this young man took me to a gay club for the first time that I went. And it was absolutely exhilarating to me. It felt like for the first time I was with people who understood me, who were like me. I didn't feel anyone was judging me. I felt like this was what life was about. Just be happy, just dance, just enjoy the music, and be who you are. And instantly, all of my defenses came down when I was in this gay club. It was like I was always meant to be in this place. And I think from there, I began this process of assimilation into gay culture, gay life, being a gay man and embracing that identity for myself. And I want to sort of add a caveat that I never believed that I was born gay. That was never a concept in my mind. It was just something that, I guess, logically to me didn't make sense. And so I never adopted that belief. But I did embrace an identity as a gay man, and I lived that way for 11 years. For the 11 years that I was in homosexuality, or we like to call it the lifestyle, from what I saw, homosexuality, or the gay life, gay culture, was about finding a sex partner and satisfying yourself. It was about having fun. It was about throwing away any kind of conventional restrictions that prevented you from having the fun that you wanted. It was complete freedom from my eyes. That's what it was. Homosexuality is a double-sided coin, I think, for a lot of people. And for me, it presented the best of both worlds. Even with numerous sexual partners, even with the freedom that I felt, I began to do things that I thought I would never do. That never entered into my mind, my imagination to do. When I was in that context, I felt like I would do whatever I felt like doing and nobody could stop me. But when the lights went down, when the party was over, when the sex stopped, there was still this terribly empty loneliness in my heart that the clubs could not satisfy, sexual partners could not satisfy, the freedom that I felt, it couldn't satisfy that. And I kind of felt like many times I was chasing a ghost. I participated in orgies and I went to public sex places and just many degrading things that, of course, I'm very ashamed of now. But that was the life that I saw, that I participated. And to tell you the truth, that everyone else around me participated in the same thing. There was no difference. The sense of fidelity and commitment within a relationship, a sexual relationship in the gay community, is vastly different than what heterosexuals understand it to be. Not only did I participate in sexual activities with people who said they were in committed relationships, I actively pursued them because I felt like there were no restrictions. No one that I ever encountered said, hey, I am partnering with this person and I do not want to step outside of that. Willing sex partners, whether so-called committed or not, were just as free as those who were not in any kind of relationship. And so what I hear now about, as the gay community tries to paint itself as this very traditional sense of morality and traditional sense of commitment and relationship, it is a polar opposite to what I experienced personally while I was in homosexuality. That last year that I was in the lifestyle, a great change began in my heart, and I began thinking those feelings of worthlessness turned into suicidal thoughts. And I always felt like this. There were a lot of people I felt that had hurt me in my life, people who were not there for me. And I felt the same way about God. I hated God. I felt that he had betrayed me, that he had left me to be brutalized, that he would not hear my prayers. And I felt like he was just somebody who didn't care about me. Of all the people in the world I thought should care, I would think God would care about me. But my experience with him said to me that he doesn't care. And so when I began seeing my life as very worthless and hopeless, I got to thinking, well, maybe you should just check out of here. Maybe this is it for you. And I really felt that I would just, if I was going to hell, that I would die a homosexual and I would go to hell and I didn't care anymore. You know, maybe it was better than the struggle of my life, which was this exhilarating high when I was clubbing and partying and sexing, and then this very deep low when I felt lonely and alone and rejected. And those were the sort of two extremes of my life. And also what I decided to do is I was going to write a letter and I was going to list everyone's name who had ever hurt me and had abandoned me. And I was going to say in the letter, you are the reason that I killed myself, because I wanted to hurt them one last time before I left this earth. I wanted them to know what I felt they had done to me. And perhaps I blamed them for what my life had become. And I sat down in the chair in front of my television. And I guess by habit, I don't know, I just turned the television on and I began to watch it. And it was an amazing scene on the television. It was a story being played out. And I saw in the distance a man, and he was carrying something. He was dragging something. I also saw the faces of the people They were screaming at him. They were throwing things at him. They were reaching for him like, as if they wanted to just kill him. And I could not, for the life of me, understand what had this man done for these people to hate him so much. And one of the things I saw in this movie that shocked me was I saw my own face in the crowd. And when I saw that, I was shocked to my core that I was there hating this man who was moving towards me. And then at a certain point, he got up to the, I guess what would be the front of the television screen, but it was almost like a 3D movie. Everything froze except him. And his face came out of the television at me, and he said to me, "I did all of this just for you." And when I heard that, tears leapt into my eyes because I wanted to die. And I didn't think anybody heard me or saw me. And I could not believe that he would say to me that he endured this for me, that he took this pain, this what these people were doing to him, he did it for me. And at that time, I realized that it was Jesus. And a voice said to me, "You've done too much and God is not going to forgive you. You've sinned too much. You've done too much. He's not going to forgive you." And as soon as that voice finished speaking, another voice said to me, "But if you ask him, he will." And I was conflicted about what should I do. Should I ask God to forgive me? Because I knew that I had lived a life that was terrible. I hated God in my heart. I didn't want any part of him. I had rejected everything I knew about him. But here he is offering me an opportunity to come to him. And so I decided that I would ask God to forgive me. And I decided I would stand up and I would get on my knees because I really didn't know what to say. I was afraid that I would pray and then God would say, "No, I don't want to hear you because you had your chance and you didn't take it." But when I stood up to get on my knees, I literally fell on my face on the floor. And I was in a little gray trailer that I lived in, the same trailer that men, sexual partners had come in and out of. The same place. I fell on my face before God and I began to ask him, "How could you love me knowing all that I've done?" It befuddled me because my conception of love was I had to do something for him to love me. And here he was saying, "I love you regardless of what you've done." And I wasn't convinced of that. There were some situations that I had gotten myself involved in when I was in Germany, and it was very degrading type of stuff. And I began to tell him, I said, "Don't you remember when I did this?" And he stopped me when I was telling. He said to me, "But I love you." And some way I became convinced that God loved me, even though I had done all of these things, that I had went so far out that perhaps no one could reach me. And I decided that day that I wanted to be in relationship with him no matter what. And I took him up on his offer. I asked him that day to forgive me. I don't know how long that I laid on my face, but when I got up, I was a new man. I was a new creation. All the old things had passed away and my life had become new on that day. And it began this process, the journey that I love so much that I'm on today. I didn't know what to expect. All I knew was I wanted him more than life itself. He said to me, "Foster, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I'll be with you always, even until the end of this world." And I have held on to that as my rock, the words that keep me and have propelled me forward. So it was beyond my wildest expectations, what God did for me on that day.
Hi guys, today I'm going to be sharing some of my testimony with you. A little bit of background, grew up in a Christian house. Didn't really understand that there was more to Jesus. I never really questioned that there was a God. I always believed in him, but I just didn't really understand that there was more than going to church on Sundays. I didn't understand the aspect of having a relationship with him. So when I was about 16 or 17, my parents divorced. It wasn't really a big deal for me. I guess I was kind of upset, but with that came a lot of freedom. I was able to go and do kind of whatever I wanted. There wasn't really that much accountability for me. And for a 16 or 17 year old girl, having a lot of freedom like that is probably not the best thing. So I did what a lot of teenage girls would do. Went out, partied, had fun with friends. A lot of promiscuity, a lot of drinking, just not drug abuse necessarily, but I experimented with a lot. So fast forward 2009, I meet who is now my husband. So we meet, none of the partying stopped. Didn't think it was that big of a deal. There was just a lot of dysfunction, a lot of codependency on my part, addiction on his part, drugs, alcohol. There was lying, cheating. It was a nightmare. We'd break up, get back together, break up, get back together. Fast forward a little more, 2011, find out that I am pregnant, 2 months pregnant, with my daughter Ella. And I remember we were both so happy, so excited. We were young, I was 21. So naturally, when you're going to have a baby, you stop partying, you get things together. You know, you have to grow up. And it became apparent that he was not ready. And it got to the point where it was really bad, where we had to separate ourselves. And I went, and I was actually living with my mother-in-law at the time. And when I went into labor, he had gotten kicked out of his grandmother's house and he was living in his car. He barely made it to the delivery. He didn't have a phone. He was virtually homeless. The first 2 months after my daughter was born, it was really hard. I was exhausted. I was doing everything on my own. I didn't see him probably for the first 2 months. He was really hard to get a hold of. With him not really being in the picture, there was a lot of resentment and bitterness on my end towards him. Of course, I wanted my family together. I wanted him to be a part of my daughter's life and my life, and I loved him with all my heart. But it got to the point where I couldn't stand to be around him. I didn't want to be around him. So my daughter's about 1 year old and we were still separated. We were kind of trying to work things out. So one afternoon I get a text from one of my friends and there's a couple pictures of him with another girl. And we weren't technically together, but we were kind of trying to work things out. I remember just laying on my bed and I felt like my heart was literally going to break. And we had been through a lot, but it was never to that point. I literally thought I was going to die of a broken heart, and it was a horrible feeling. So what do I do? Make it better by start dating somebody else, which in reality was probably the worst thing I could have done at that point. So he's with somebody else and I'm with somebody else, and there was a lot of arguing between us. And after 3 or 4 months of dating each other, I find out that I am pregnant, and that was a horrible, horrible feeling. Just to be in the place where things were so chaotic and this other relationship was not healthy at all. Drinking, lying, cheating, same stuff. And I just felt like I was stuck and I had nowhere to go. So I decided to move back home and I made the choice to have an abortion. On top of it, my youngest brother, who was born with a mitochondrial disorder, he was in hospice. And it was kind of a surreal thing because he had been sick for a long time and we didn't think that, you know, this was anything different, but the doctors were saying that he didn't have much longer to live. Just the chaos surrounding all of that was just too much. Right after my brother passed away, me and my husband, we kind of started talking again. He had broken up with the girl he was seeing, and I was no longer with the guy I had been seeing. And I felt like things were finally going to start moving in the right direction, and my family was going to be back together. And ultimately, that's what I really wanted. I kind of wanted to put God first, and I didn't really realize how to do that. I didn't know how to do that, but I just had this idea that that's what I wanted. Once again, things are good for about 3 or 4 months, and then I find out that he had been using. So at that point, I had kind of just had enough, and I'm like, I can't do this anymore. I have to put my daughter first, and I can't let her be around that, and I can't be around that because it's not healthy for me either. So 6 months in, my husband, he makes a decision that he is going to go to Teen Challenge. And if you don't know what Teen Challenge is, it's like a faith-based rehab where they don't really deal with drug abuse in the sense that they do the 12 steps. They just teach you about how to have a relationship with Christ, and they put that at the center of that. So he's 12 days into the program. We go and we visit him, and it was a complete transformation already, you could tell. And I was so excited. I could just see the difference in him. He looked healthier. He acted so much happier. And the program is a year program. And that was really hard. I was glad that he was where he was at. I didn't have to worry about what he was doing, you know, or if he was using. So about 9 months into his program, we went and visited him again. And I remember sitting at the table and he was just crying. And he was just so sorry for everything that he had done. And I remember looking at him and thinking, wow, like there must be something more. There must be something more to Jesus than what I've known, because to see him acting like this and to be so sincere, it just made me want to have my own relationship with God in a way that I didn't understand. But I remember driving home one day and I was on the freeway and I looked up at this billboard and just this thought popped into my head, wow, this is his time to be gone and this is my time to be, you know, work on myself. This is my time to work on myself. And I decided then that I was going to start seeking God and have my own relationship with him. So I just remember this hunger. I remember feeling this urge, this urgency to just get into the Bible. And I just wanted to read. And I didn't understand half of the stuff that I was reading, but I just had a desire to get into the Word. For once in a long time, I had a joy. I had a peace. I had a hope. I was able to be away from my husband, who was my fiance at the time, for a year and be okay with that and not be completely missing him to where it was really hard and really devastated me. And then out of nowhere, I got sick. I got bladder infections. And then it turned into a sinus infection, and then it turned into an ear infection, and I was on antibiotic after antibiotic and nothing seemed to be helping. And then through all of that, I just developed a really bad fear and anxiety. And anxiety, not necessarily of death, but just really bad panic attacks. A fear that there was something more serious going on. Why am I always sick? I would be afraid to wake up in the morning because I remember I'd get up and I'd go to get ready for work and I would be afraid to look in the mirror because I was afraid that today was going to be like yesterday and that I was gonna be sick today and I wasn't gonna feel good today. And that went on for about 10 months. That was just a miserable time. And all the antibiotics caused me to develop heart palpitations, so that was just something else to add on to the anxiety. Nothing was helping. I was taking Xanax. There were multiple trips to doctors, to emergency rooms, and I just felt like I couldn't get better. And I remember my mother-in-law giving me a scripture, the scripture that the Lord does not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. And I remember just saying that over and over, and I didn't understand what I was doing, but I just knew that it made me feel better. So my husband graduated from Teen Challenge in July of 2014. 2 days later, we got married. I planned a wedding in 3 months and I was so excited and we were both so happy and it just seemed really surreal. So we get married, we have a week honeymoon, my husband's home for a couple weeks and then he goes back to Teen Challenge to do a 2 month internship. And within that 2 month time frame, something really shifted for me. I became really depressed for no reason. I started having these really bad negative thoughts against my daughter, thoughts that I wanted to take my life, and I didn't understand what was happening. I didn't understand that there was a warfare. And I remember just overwhelming thoughts of wanting to kill myself, but I knew that that wasn't me, and I didn't have a desire to do that. I just didn't understand why I was feeling like that. I became very agitated with the people around me. These thoughts were making me feel like I was absolutely crazy. I thought I was going insane. I didn't understand. I didn't know what to do. And during this whole time, I didn't say anything to anybody. I was really good at being normal and happy on the outside, but on the inside, I could feel myself screaming. I just wanted it to stop. I wanted peace. I wanted rest, and I couldn't get it. So like I said, nobody knew this was going on. My husband's aunt had been texting me that she wanted to meet with me. And at first I put it off. I didn't really know what to say or how to go about doing that without people knowing what I was feeling. But it got to the point where I was so desperate for help that I really felt like I needed to meet with her. So we ended up meeting on a Thursday night, and I don't even remember really what we were saying to each other, but I just remember feeling an immense peace. I just felt something different. And I always laugh about it because I tell her now, what I know now was the Holy Spirit. I remember she was praying for me and my eyelids were twitching and I didn't understand why, but I just felt I left there feeling a huge amount of peace. So she gave me Brian and Katie Torwalt's CD as a gift, the one that has Holy Spirit on it. So I'm driving to work the next day and I'm listening to it and I feel like I had heard it before, but I wasn't really sure. But for some reason I knew the words. So it gets to the part and I start singing, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And then all of a sudden, right when I say those words, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here, I get this flash in my head of this picture, and it's me laying over the side of my bed that night that I found out that my husband was with another girl, and I just remember my heart was broken, and I got that flash, and a voice came into my head, and it wasn't an audible voice, but it was like a thought, but I knew that it came from somewhere else. I knew it was God, and he said, I was there with you. And to just know that that was one of the lowest points of my life and that he was there with me. He was there. And to know that the God of the universe that created everything saw me and he loved me and he was there with me through that. That in itself is just a miracle. And that is everything. And that is everything. That completely changed everything. And then immediately right after he said that, I just felt warmth. I just felt literally like Jesus was there and he was hugging me, like as if I were to go and hug you. And to feel that love from him, to know how much that you are loved by him, that just changes everything in an instant, changes everything. And I remember looking up and I saw the birds and the birds looked different. The birds, it's just like everything was pointing to Jesus. And it's like, I don't know how I didn't see that before. And honestly, I don't even remember getting to work. I don't know how I got to work. I don't know if my boss was there. I don't remember anything except for an hour straight. It was like he was just hugging me and he was just showing me how much he loved me. And from that point on, it's just been constant pursuit of Jesus. And instantly all of the voices were gone. Those thoughts were gone. I could see clearly. I could hear clearly. It's just, unless you experience that, it's hard to even explain it. It's just such a supernatural experience. It was like from black to white. I was not at all the same person that I was 2 seconds before that happened. And then comes that realization that he doesn't just love me that way. He loves everybody that way. And all I wanted to do was leave and tell people about Jesus. It was just absolutely mind-blowing that there's more to this life. There's more that people don't understand. There's Christians that don't understand this. I grew up as one, but my hope, my desire is that people will see my life and people that have been through similar things as me will know that there is hope. You don't have to live depressed. You don't have to live in fear. You don't have to live with anxiety or panic attacks. You know that you are valuable and you are loved, and there's a God that sees you. He sees you for the way that he created you. He sees you not for all of the things that you've done, but for what his son Jesus did. So I just wanted to say God bless you guys.
Largest displacement of people since World War II. 1 in 4 people out of their homes in Syria. Millions here in Iraq. Behind me, the Iraqi capital of ISIS, Mosul, the biblical city of Nineveh. Minutes from the nearest ISIS village here in the extreme north, miles from Syria and Turkey. How does a Christian respond to the worst atrocity since Hitler?
Between the civil war in Syria and the advance of ISIS in the Middle East, 14 million people have been forced to flee their homes, more than half of them children. Iraqi and Syrian refugees are in desperate need. Many are living in refugee camps in northern Iraq, while others are risking death and homelessness as they attempt to reach Europe and even North America.
we are standing at Mar Hormiz, which is Saint Hormiz. It's an ancient monastery in the Nineveh governorate. We are overlooking the Nineveh Plains. If you look out over our shoulder here, those are the ancient Nineveh Plains. Mosul is just off in the distance.
And Mosul can be translated Nineveh.
That's right. Ancient Nineveh, as we know it from our holy book, the Bible, is modern-day Mosul.
Okay.
ISIS is only 15 kilometers away from where we are here. And we, as an organization, Samaritan's Purse, are here to respond to the needs, the crisis that's happened since ISIS came and disrupted life here for so many Iraqis. There's now been over 3 million Iraqis displaced in the recent time with ISIS in the fight. And so Samaritan's Purse has come in bringing relief, water, food. We've set up tents for shelter for these families that have been displaced. And so everything that we do as an organization, as Samaritan's Purse, is geared towards sharing Christ, sharing the love of Jesus Christ. We believe that this is the hope of the world. And so whether we're drilling a well for a community or playing with children and putting in a playground for them or partnering with the local church here on the ground, we're all doing that in the effort of bringing honor and glory to Jesus Christ.
Look at all that ISIS has done to Christians, to many of your own churches, but especially to the Yazidis, to the young women that they've taken, to the young women that are still being held. What is a Christian to do? How are we to think?
Actually, all the world, they thought that ISIS took from us everything, but actually, we took from them everything.
Explain that.
They took our houses, but we are one home. Mm. We are one land. We are one place. Mm-hmm. They took from us all churches, but we are now one church. They are covering, you know, their faces actually. Mm. But we are we can showing our faces. We don't have anything to feel guilty about it or to be hidden. Mm. But those people can't come to the light. But we are the light.
You are the light. We have the light.
We have the light. We do. So those people, they can't live in light. They will live in dark. So they took from us everything. But actually, no one can touch our joy. No one can touch our faith. Because we are not belong to land. We are belong to Jesus. Jesus is our land. Not the land of Nineveh. Where we have Jesus, that means we have the promised land. Without Jesus, doesn't matter which place we are living.
Jesus is protecting his church in Iraq and the Middle East, and he's also growing it. Many are coming to know him. Before Shirzad Suleiman came to know Jesus, he called himself a bad guy. He was in the Iraqi army. After Saddam Hussein fell, he became a civil engineer for a cell phone company. One day, while working on a phone tower, he was kidnapped by Islamic terrorists who wanted ransom money for his life.
He kidnapped me. He put me in the back of the car. And
this is a group of guys that did this to you?
Yes, but he's talking about Muslim name. Because when he took me to the place, he kidnapped me there, I forget the name of the exactly the place, but the original place is Samarra. And he catch me there, he put me 4 days every 2 hours. He said, Allahu Akbar is like name of God. He punched me by AK, and I don't know if the camera, he can zoom in.
He's taking his AK-47 and he's beating you with
beating me, yeah. And I don't know if the camera, he can make zoom. He broken my nose, he broken my knee, and for 6 months I stay in hospital just for my kidney. Really, he gave me a hard time. But the amazing thing happened with me, he changed me from bad guys to good guys. When he punched me by AK, I don't know what's happened with me. I'm sleeping or not, I don't know. Like somebody, he came in, he speak Arabic with me.
Okay, we're talking about a dream now.
Yes, I'm not exactly dream, because I hear the people when he talking, and I hear him when he talk to me. I see him but the people he not see him. Like, speak Arabic with me, he said, I am Isa. Like in English, I'm Jesus.
Go so to it, so Sherrod, this is either an appearance from Jesus or a dream, you're not sure which.
Yes.
But what did Jesus tell you?
He speak Arabic with me. He said, Ana Isa, I am Jesus. Go to home. I told him, are you serious? You see these people, he kidnapped me. And I see him, he sit in the middle of him. He told me, go to home. And I open my eyes, I see the bad guys and this group of Islam. He fight each other, and one of them, he used the AK, he shoot his friend. And I open the door, I go to the highway, I take taxi, and I come back. But it's not finished, the story is not finished yet.
So you through this miraculous, because it is miraculous, mm-hmm. way, you were able to just flee, leave, walk away, yeah. take a taxi home.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's not finished here. When I coming to home, after 3 days, because the company, I called the company, hey, I release it now. He said, who release you? I told him, Jesus. And everybody, he laughed. Yeah, like you now.
Well, I believe it. Yeah. I hope he did. Yeah.
And the problem is not here. Like after 3 days, I go to home. My wife, she opened the door for me. She said, hey, what happened with you? I told him, group of Islam, he kidnapped me. She said, I see Jesus in my dream. He told me, I save your husband. He's in safe. He coming soon to home.
So this is a double event here. Jesus is speaking to you. Jesus is speaking to your wife. You've been kidnapped by yes. terrorists, yes. And the Lord leads you safely back home.
Yes, and now I'm not afraid from anything, because Jesus, he saved me one time. He's going to save me second time. And anyone who not believe Jesus, please, if he see me now or he look it to me, sorry, maybe my English is not good, but please, please send my message to everybody. Jesus, he is here. He will save our life. And thanks for anyone. He listened to me and believe Jesus. He is like our food. He is our blood. He is everything in my life now.
As a parts in one body, and the head of the body, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
I want from you to pray for us and to all people that are listening to this and watching this program, to pray to our people here and to help our people and to save our people. I'm not here for begging for help, because this is our duty to help each other.
Yes.
We are here, the Christian here actually, they saw the devil, the face of devil. And we know who is the devil here in this modern life. We know that very well. And many people, they are afraid to say that. Me, I don't care, because I belong to Jesus, not anyone. Well, actually, we are suffering from Muslim. And we did our part to them for many, many years, you know? But in any case, if someone want to reject or refuse the grace to us, we are still continue. We are still, by the grace of Lord, we are still forgive, and we can grow up, and still taking care about the community. That means the next community, the next generation, our kids. And this is important.
It may seem like ISIS is winning. It may seem like Islam is winning. But if all of the Christians leave, then there's nothing left here for those that remain. And so we have to remain faithful to the calling God's placed on our life. Samaritan's Purse stands ready to go into the worst places and bring the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's a privilege. We have fallen in love in the 5 years that we've been here in Iraq. We've fallen in love with Iraqis. They are an amazing people, and they're children of God. He loves them, and he wants every one of them to call him Lord and Savior. And so that's the mission of our organization.
Start with a cup of water, a loaf of bread. Christians share the love of Christ in tangible ways, praying for the displaced,
the children taken from parents, the parents uprooted from their towns and villages, Christians, Yazidis, other minorities. Would you join me in being the hands and feet of Jesus? Would you, together with me, look to the cross and share the cross of Christ with others?
So this is actually just a little snippet of my testimony. Jesus saved me. I'm completely grateful in every way. But what I really want to say is that a couple years ago, I was at my lowest point. I had major depression. I was battling PTSD. Basically, in a nutshell, I was completely losing my mind. Scared to death. I'd wake up in the morning and I didn't want to be awake. And so one day I was crying in my car. I was bawling. I didn't really know who Jesus was. I heard the name. I knew who God was. I prayed when I was younger a little bit, but I basically just got separated from God. And so I was in my car and I was crying and I was like asking God, like, am I going to go to heaven? I didn't know what was going on whatsoever. And as I was driving, I looked up and God showed me this church. As I continued to drive, I looked up and seen this giant sign that said Jesus. And from that point on, God saved my life. Because I've completely given myself to God, He's healed me from depression and PTSD all within a 2-year period. He's also saved my relationship, and I'm getting married, which is amazing. He saved my relationship with my daughter. He has helped my brother get off the streets and off of meth, and my brother's been saved. We were actually baptized together. He's working on saving my little sister. He's also made up for lost time with my mom. She's staying with me, and it's been very, very peaceful and wonderful. God is so, so good. I just love Him with all my heart. So many, many things. Brought me out of addiction, which is totally cool. Who the Son sets free is definitely free indeed. Once I figured out to let go of addiction, my life with Jesus has just exploded. It's amazing. That was actually just the start of many, many miracles to come. God has done some amazing stuff in my life, and I am completely grateful. I love Jesus with all of my heart now, and I can honestly say that He is by far the best thing that has ever happened to me.
I can remember the minute that I became dissatisfied, or a better word would be disgusted, with my life. It's like 7, 8, 9 years ago. I remember the house, I remember the basement, I remember the ping pong table I was standing next to. For whatever reason, this party, at this time, God chose to take me from something that used to bring me joy, right? Hanging out with my buddies, drinking, doing whatever. All of a sudden, I wasn't into it anymore, and it brought me shame and guilt. So I did what anybody does, right? When they got to get cleaned up, I went to church. Thought that would do it. So I go to church. This is up in Portland, and go to New Hope. But I wasn't feeling the hope. I was feeling the guilt. I just felt like everything I was dissatisfied with, everything I was disgusted with in my life, was just amplified at church. I would have gone back to my previous ways if I wasn't so fed up with that lifestyle, if I wasn't so, you know, so sick of it. So I pressed on and started paying attention to some of the few Christian people in my life, and started. Taking a closer note of how they were living their life. Started reading this old book, you know, the Bible, that didn't make any sense to me. at the time. One day, after church, of course, I was feeling exceptionally guilty. I can remember the car that I was sitting in, and I remember the place that I was at. I look in the back of the book, I look in the back of the Bible, under the word guilt, and it takes me to Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is all about King David, right? After he had done the atrocious things he did, murder, adultery, and he's pouring his heart out in this psalm. And for the first time in my life, like it connected, right? This story of this sad king, somehow just put into words everything that I was feeling at that minute. I wanted everything that David wanted. He wanted a new heart, right? He was begging for forgiveness. He wanted a new heart. He wanted a new righteousness. He was begging God for this. And I hadn't known what I had wanted. I knew I didn't want this previous life that I was living, but I was able to point to Psalm 51 and say, that's it. That's what I want. I felt the burden, right, start to lift off of me. This burden that I've been carrying of guilt and shame and all this stuff, I could just breathe, like take a little bit deeper of a breath. That was a big deal, but I still had this feeling from my past, these years where I just felt like I wasted them. And then I heard someone talk about another verse that gives you the freedom to forget kind of our past and to focus on Jesus. And I scrambled to the Bible, first Bible I could find, look it up. It was Philippians 3:13, forgetting what lies behind and focusing on the goal of the upward call of Christ Jesus, right? This was again, music to my ears. I don't even think I knew what the goal of the upward call of Christ Jesus was, but I landed on forgetting what lies behind and I took it and ran with it. Man, that was what sealed the deal and allowed me to move beyond my past, to stop looking backwards, but to look forward, to apply the gospel to my life and to help other people do the same thing. Not only does my past not plague me like it did, right, with guilt and with shame and with failure, this feeling of failure, now it brings me joy. Not to say that my past, that I wouldn't do things differently, I totally would if I had to do it over again, but I can't, and that it's a part of who I am. And so I think about my past now and I smile and think about, not only does it not bring me guilt, but my past brought me Jesus. How can you not be thankful for that?
I came to God when I was just 14 years old, like a year ago. I'm kidding. No, I came to God when I was just 14 years old. And after that day, I was like, wow, life can be good. I had a lot of sorrow, you know, rejection in my heart. I was just a very sad person. And I felt like I had like absolutely no identity whatsoever. Like, I just felt like, I was like, okay, what is life right now? Like, are we just born to live a cycle and then just like kind of die? Like, it didn't really make much sense to me, you know? So I met Jesus and everything changed from there. I was able to see a whole new perspective on life. I was able to have my eyes open and see life for what it really was. Not only that, but God literally showed me the love of a father. He showed me more love than anyone could ever show me or anybody has ever shown me. It's been about 11 years since I gave my heart and my soul to him. And to be perfectly honest, they've been like the very, very best years of my life. He literally has given me everything that money cannot buy. You know, money can buy you a house, but it can't make it a home. Money can buy you materialistic things, but it can't buy you the happiness. He gave me a peace inside of my heart, and he's giving me joy and love for everyone, you know, to a point where I used to, you know, there comes a point in our lives where we just grow so cold and so bitter that we begin to hate people and we grow cold-hearted. And God was just like, no, like, I'm going to give you the same love that I have for you. I'm going to give it to you for everyone. Like, the person who I was before is like, you know, who was I even? God has transformed me in such a way that I can't even imagine. And he's still transforming me. I'm still changing by his grace and by his love every day. And, you know, many people think to say, oh, that church brainwashed them and this and that. And, you know, I'm sure you guys have heard it all. But at the end of the day, like, it's not that. It's God himself who has the power to change someone's heart. He literally wants to do the same thing for you. Like, I really feel like you guys are missing out if you don't give him your heart. You know, that's the reason why I decided to create a YouTube channel in hopes that, you know, this channel can bring you hope and bring you to a new relationship with God in a whole new level, help you experience his love in a whole new level. There was actually a verse that I read today that really stood out to me and inspired me to make this video. And I'm going to read it to you guys really quick. It's in the book of Psalms. No, it's actually Psalms, but I like to say Psalms 16:11. It says, you make to me known the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. So pretty much, you know, in this verse is talking about how God pretty much opens up the path of life for us. And he fills us with joy in his presence and how much joy we can receive by being close to him. We have an amazing God, and God has everything. He owns everything, and he still desires to have a relationship individually with each and every one of us.
I was born in Juneau, Alaska, born in a log cabin, and raised in a family that attended church fairly regularly, maybe 5 times a year, and went to church because they knew it was good. And they liked the social aspect of being surrounded with nice people. Although I don't remember a Bible in my house growing up, but I'm sure my parents had one each somewhere. In Alaska, we had a tongue-talking church. And there are a lot of people. Some of my friends in the community that were not Christian would say, don't go to that church, it's the tongue-talking church. They'll be talking in crazy tongues or something. And they mocked it, and they said, don't join that cult. And when I was 16, a couple girls invited me to the church youth group on Wednesday night. Who knows, youth groups are important, yeah. It was a Wednesday night middle school, high school youth group. I was 16, just got my driver's license in Alaska, driving. So I drove to church, went in, sat through the service, and I kind of had my arms crossed and thinking, you know, the message, the preacher was preaching his message, and I was thinking, yeah, sounds nice. I agree with some of the things that the preacher is saying, but I'm not joining this cult. And then at the end of the service, the preacher stood up. He's up there and he said, everybody stand up and sing this song about Jesus, you know. And then everyone started singing. He says, everybody come to the front. So all the kids shuffled forward and went to the front. And I didn't want to be left in the last man standing, so I followed suit. And then he said, I feel like the Holy Spirit's going to move. Everybody hold hands. And they were singing the song, you know, about Jesus. And then, so I looked to the right and grabbed some funny looking Christian girl's hand, maybe. And I looked to the left and some other, you know, funny looking person's hand. And as soon as I grabbed the second person's hand, God ripped my soul from my body, and I was instantly skydiving down to the lake of fire. So, whether, as Paul says in the Bible, whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. But I was gone out of my body, in my spirit. So I was in another dimension, skydiving down as I am now, from about 6,000 feet down to a massive lake. And I wouldn't describe it like a pond. I would describe it like an ocean sound. And instead of water, it's lava, burning sulfur. And of course, lakes are surrounded by mountains and or land, and there was mountains. It was burnt, charred black. Instead of nice trees that you would see here on Earth, it's burnt, charred black mountains that have been just scorched. And the sky was red, from illuminated from the lake that was glowing red, giving light. There was quite a lot of light there. You could clearly see the whole lake. And as I skydived down 6,000, 5,000, 4,000, 3,000, 2,000, 1,000 feet, I could start to see the bodies swimming. And they were, each body had their own plot in the lake. So like people spend their whole lives fighting for a chunk of land on this earth and buy it, so is the destiny for those who deny Jesus Christ and his ways. They're going to have their plot in the lake of fire. And it appeared that they couldn't, there wasn't groups of people together, so there was just single people spaced out 50 feet, 100 feet, 200 feet apart, and they were treading lava, just like you would tread water. So I often go to the swimming pool and to the deep end or go and swim in the lake, and I every time I think about that, because you know, you can imagine trying to tread water for eternity, and then you know, you could try to imagine treading lava for eternity. So that's it's quite a thought. So I had never read the Bible a day in my life at this point. I didn't know about Jesus talking about a lake of fire or you know, the book of Revelation talking about the beast and the false prophet, I think, thrown into the lake of fire. And all the people that follow them eventually being thrown into the lake of fire. So at 1,000 feet, I could see the bodies just like you would look down on the floor and see specks of dirt on the floor. I began to see bodies at about 1,500 feet elevation. I could see the bodies swimming. And 900, 800, 700 feet, I can see I'm going towards a guy. I'm headed straight for this guy. 600, 500, 400, 300, and I realize I'm actually going right for this guy. I'm going to land on another guy. 500, 400, 300, 200, 100, and it's happening so fast, you know. At about 100 feet, 90 feet, I'm flailing. Something grabs my hand and swings my feet down. 90, 80, 70, 60, 50, 40, 30, 20. I'm slowing down. 15, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. And I'm dangling above the lake of fire, above this guy, at 5 feet above the guy. And he's swimming chest deep in lava there. He's swimming chest deep, and he reaches up and tries to grab my hand, my foot, and not to pull me down, but to get the hell out of there. Because you could see in his eyes he's in serious pain, agony. And I could see he's just swimming. So he reaches up and he misses my foot. Just misses my foot. He just missed it. And then he realized he missed it. And then he reaches up with his other hand to try to grab again. But it's too late. I've already begun to go back up. 5 feet, 10 feet, and he screams, no, and I'm beginning to go back up, looking this guy dead in the eye, and as I'm being pulled back up, 5 feet, 10 feet, we begin to accelerate very fast, faster than any speeding car I've been in, faster than any airplane, faster than any roller coaster taking off, and I look up, 50, 100, 200, 400, you know, I look up and an angel has me by the hand. And his sandals are right here by my face. And his wings were coming down and his feathers on the wings were pure white and this big. And he was dressed in white, a white robe. I don't know, he or she, I didn't see it, the angel's face. But I saw that it was an angel, that had me by the hand, and I looked back down, and I could see the, and I said to myself, oh my God, God is real. Oh my God, God is real. Oh my God, God is real. Then I took mental snapshots of what I was seeing, so I'll never forget it. And I said, I'll never forget this, I'll never forget this. Oh, oh my God, I'll never forget this. And I just snapped it in. It's like a sound, the lake goes on beyond past the islands. It's a big, big lake. Someone told me that the entire world population today can fit shoulder to shoulder into the square, into the square miles or area that Jacksonville, Florida takes up. So you got to figure like there's going to be a lot of bodies, a lot of souls swimming there. And it's a big lake. So then I'm 1,000, 2,000 feet. I have about a 15 second ride back up. And we got to the kind of cloud, you know, ceiling level of, at 6,000 feet, there was kind of, I don't know if it was clouds or, I guess it wasn't clouds. It was just kind of this red ceiling. And when we reached that level, way, you know, as high as we, you know, way up there, I was instantly back in the church, and I was holding hands with these two random girls, middle school girls, whatever, funny looking Christian girls, singing some song about Jesus, like, gee, eyes closed, everybody holding hands in the front of this, and they were saying, Jesus, Jesus, and I looked to the right, and I looked to the left, I said, did you see that? Did anybody see that? Oh my God, is what I said. I said, oh my God. And I was shocked a little bit. And then the service ended right then. The song was over. He said, everybody have a great week. Whatever he's saying, you know, come back next week. Make sure you pray and read your Bible. And I was shocked. And then everybody went back to their chairs, grabbed their jackets, went out to the hallway of the church. And then I was shocked, I was speechless. And then I began to listen to my Christian friends that were there, and they were talking about sports and gossip after the service. And I was shocked again because Jesus is real. Okay, hell's real, angels are real. That means the Bible's real. That means Jesus is real. That means people are burning in hell. That means that we need to learn what the Bible says and do it. And then afterwards, I was just thinking maybe these Christians would be starting talking about Jesus after the service. I think they talked about, you know, the football games, you know, parties, who said what. You know, things of the world. When I needed to hear about Jesus and salvation and God's ways and the truth. But I didn't find that immediately after the service. So I don't know. I think I said to someone, God showed me he's real. And they said, oh yeah, great, he's real. Da-da-da-da-da, did you hear about the Seahawks? Da-da-da-da-da, oh my God. Da-da-da-da-da, did you hear about this? Da, 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 you know, just whatever. I'm just thinking, like, really? Like, this is what this church is. I don't think it was the church that, you know, made them like that. I think the world made the kids like that, you know, and the church is trying to correct that. So I think that's what the world does. It makes you conform to the image of the world.
Well, what a blessing these testimonies have been. I pray that they have encouraged you in some way, given you some hope, and assuredly some direction. If you've not made a commitment to Jesus Christ, I pray that this will be a turning point in your life where you say, I need a change. I need to be right with God. I need His blessing to start flowing in my life. You see, my friend, Jesus Christ paid the full penalty for you to be free from the burdens of your sin. And you can give those burdens to Him right now. If you need help, whatever you're dealing with in life, He's God. He has the power to bring about change. Whatever is needed to have changed in your life, He has the power to change it. But you have to make a commitment first to Jesus before you are eligible for His power. Pray with me if you have never prayed a simple prayer asking forgiveness for your sins. Do it in your own way. You can follow after me if you want. Jesus, I admit to you that I need a Savior. I admit to you that I need to be right with you. I admit to you that I'm a sinner and I ask forgiveness of all of my sins. I ask you to fill me with the Holy Spirit to empower me to say no to future temptations to sin. I ask, Father, in Jesus' name, that you enlighten the Word to me. Help the Word of God, the Bible, come alive to me and show me what I'm to read and make it to be sense so that I can understand it. Help me to walk in right relationship with you this moment forth. And I believe you have forgiven me of all my sins, and I believe I'm okay with you now, God. I believe it. In Jesus' name, thank you. And it's as simple as that, my friend. Simple as that. Jesus will take you up on it. God the Father will take you up on it. Holy Spirit will take you up on it. He'll show you what you need to do from here on out. You can trust Him. God bless you.